Grazie Marco. This session will be handled in English because I know that especially for Business Central, the public is quite widespread. So I decided to deliver this session in English. The goal about this session is to talk about possibilities to integrate the Microsoft Power Platform with the ERP side. So in this case, Dynamics 365 Business Central. A very quick about me. I'm Stefano De Miliani. I'm from Italy. I'm an MVP for business application and a trainer for Microsoft. I work as a CTO in a Microsoft partner in Italy. And on this slide, you can see my contacts. I suggest if you have questions or something like that to reach me on Twitter or my LinkedIn accounts. The agenda for this session is to give you a brief overview of the possibilities to integrate Business Central with the Power Platform. And especially, today we'll focus our attention on presenting some features that are actually released as the preview. So we'll see the state of the art at the moment, and we'll have a focus also on the feature improvement that will be available in the next months. So the agenda, we'll talk about the available connectors between Business Central and the Power Platform. We talk a bit about how to create custom connectors when we need more. And we focus the main part of this presentation on presenting the new possibilities to integrate Business Central with the Power Platform that involves Dataverse. And so we talk about Dataverse and virtual entities. Just to give a brief overview of what we are talking today. The focus today is on Dynamics 365 and the Power Platform. And one of the pieces of this big ecosystem of applications is the ERP. The ERP inside the Dynamics 365 platform is Business Central. Business Central is the cloud-based ERP available on-premise and on SaaS now. That comes from the old NIV platform. And Business Central can be now is actually totally integrated with Office 365, with other Microsoft applications, and can also be natively integrated with the Power Platform, Power BI, Power Apps, Flow, and so on, Power Automate, and so on, by using some techniques that we see in these presentations. The first, well, I want to put our attention is the Power Platform connectors. So Power Platform relies on connectors. And if you check all the available premium connectors that you have in Power Apps and Power Automate, for example, you can see that there's a connector called Business Central. And this connector permits you to automatically connect Power Automate and Power Apps with entities exposed by Dynamics 365 Business Central easily without doing quite nothing, simply install the connector, specify the connections and the details, and then you are connected. The Business Central connectors are available for cloud and on-premises version of Business Central. They permit you to connect Business Central with Power Automate and Power Apps. These connectors are hosted on Azure. And this connector offers a set of features. For Power Automate, you have actually 12 templates available for creating workflows. Workflows means that you can create workflow for doing things like react to events that occurs on the ERP side, or also you can create workflow, for example, for approvals. You can create workflow to workflow, flow to workflow integrations, and you can also create workflows directly from Business Central, and then this workflow is saved into Power Automate and vice versa. So from Power Automate, you can create a workflow that uses Business Central entities, and then this workflow is also available from the Business Central user interface. An important thing to remember is that Business Central connectors relies on OData and on the APIs exposed natively by the Business Central platform. So I think that if you have used at least once in a time the Business Central connector from Power Automate or from Power Apps, you have discovered that these connectors does not expose all the entities you have inside the ERP, but expose a large set of standard entities. Actually, there are 12 flow templates and 52 entities exposed via on the connectors. So customer, vendor, sales order, purchase order, and so on. And you have read, write, write capabilities on these entities. So the connector can supports read writes. And all these entities are exposed via from Business Center to the connector via OData. So these are endpoints the connector connects and transparently for you offers the connections. What you can do now with the connector, with Power Automate, you can create flows, approval workflows. You can access data from Power Automate to the exposed entities, and you can also update this data based on events that occurs on Business Central. For example, you can react to when a customer is creating, you can do some things, and you can also orchestrate flows that spans from Business Central to other systems, external system, for example. It's quite powerful to do that. And for Power Apps, with Power Apps, you can create Canvas apps, you can create portals, you can access data from exposed APIs and perform read what is called the CRUD operation, so read, insert, modify, delete, and so on. This is what you can do now at the moment with the standard connectors. In the future, there are some improvements. I said at the beginning that these connectors are actually in public preview, so you can use in production, but remember that these connectors are evolving. What you can do soon, you can access data. One of the important things, I think, that the important improvements that the connector will have in the next months is permitting you to access all the APIs. So standard entities and custom entity exposed from Business Central, from Power Apps and Power Automate. This is one of the main limitations today, because today, if you want to expose your custom entity, for example, if you create an entity called task, what we see quickly in the next demo in a few minutes, you cannot do that. The standard connector don't permit you to see the task entity. If task is a table, a custom table that you have created in Business Central, but you need to create a custom connector for that. In the future, this will be available in the standard connector. So standard connector will be able to read custom APIs and standard APIs. And for that, when you use the new future custom connectors, you will be able to specify the API version that you want to use and the API category that you want to use. And so you can select standard APIs and custom APIs created by you. And this will permit to work with the connector. And when you have used the connector from Power Automate, from Power Apps, this is a slide that comes from Power Automate, you can see that the connector natively exposes to you a set of actions. So for example, you can react on when the request is changed on Business Central, when a purchase document approval is executed or something like that. I've said that one of the main limitations of the custom the standard connector is that they don't support custom entities. For that, you need to create a custom connector. And the custom connector in a Power Platform is simply a wrapper around a REST API that permits you to, from Power Auto and Power Apps, to connect to that REST APIs. And the main reason to do that is in Business Central, you need a custom connector mainly for two reasons. The first reason is that you have a new entities defined in Business Central and you want to use that entity in Power Automate or Power Apps. For that, you need to create a custom connector. And also, you need a custom connector if you need to extend a standard item, a standard entity. For example, if the standard Microsoft exposes the customer entity with a set of details. But imagine that you add a new field into the customer entity in Business Central, the ERP, And you want to see these custom fields also in Power Automate and Power Apps. The standard connectors don't expose these custom fields because relies on the standard APIs. For that, you need to create a custom connector with the custom APIs. And this is very quickly what I want to show in a moment. In business, I don't want to go too much in depth now on the business center side. So imagine in this very quick sample, imagine that I have in business central a new entity, define a new table, define call as task. This is a new entity, and I want to expose this entity to Power Automate or Power Apps. For that, I need to define an API. An API is in Business Central is easily create. You can create an API simply by defining a page object with the page type APIs. And these page objects as a set of you can define here the fields that you want to expose for your entity. So this is an API that where I want to expose the task number, the description, the due date, and the status of my tasks. And when you define an API, you need to define also some properties that defines the URL of this API. So the publisher, the group, the version, and the entity name and the entity set name. When you publish this on Business Central, you have, as in this example, I'm creating a table, a normal page for permitting to the user to insert in the task, and the API page that for external integration. When you do that in Business Central, if I open my, not the screen, sorry, but the screen I open in my Business Central, refreshing the connection. I published this extension to my Business Central tenant. And as you can see, I, for example, can open my task list. Here is a list where the user can insert tasks, for example. And I create an API. So if I goes on Visual Studio Code and I call this API, the API is a custom API. So the URL of the custom APIs in Business Central has an URL defined by a fixed part. So api.businesscenter.dynamics.com, slash version of the APIs, tenant ID, environment name, and slash API, slash a custom part defined by the properties that were defined to the API. So the publisher of the API, the group, the version of the APIs. And if I call these APIs, you can see that these APIs answer in a JSON format, say me that these are the tasks that I have into Business Central. To create a custom connect, if I want to use these API, these entities, the task entity in Power Automate, I need a custom connector. And a custom connector can be simply created very quickly, because I want to spend time on other things. Going on Power Apps or Power Automate, for example, creating a custom connector. Yeah, I have just a custom connector created previously. When you define a custom connector, you need to insert here the URL of the API that where you want to connect to use on this connector. And the host, it must be api.businesscenter.dynamics.com. And the base URL must be the other part of the URL that you have in the API. So version of the API, tenant ID, environment name, and so on. Then there's the security tab where you need to define authentication. You can use basic authentication at the moment, or you can use auth authentication. Then you can define the methods. The methods, here I defined a method called get tasks that supports the get operation, as you can see here. The get is sent to this request URL. And important to define here is that inside this URL, as you can see here, I've used the company ID as parameters, because in this way I can pass from Power Automate or Power Apps the company ID where I want to retrieve the task from. The response. You can simply create other default response and copy, simply drag and drop, copy and paste all these responses that comes from the APIs. And the Power Automate connector, the custom connectors in Power Apps or Power Automate inherits all the fields that you have in the connector. So as you can see here, I have all the fields that my APIs come from. And you can also test the connector by simply specifying the company ID as parameters. And if I test the operation, you should see that the connectors answers with the task. You can now use this connector for Power Automate or Power Apps. This is the way to expose custom entities or to modify standard entities. But there's more now. And more means the integration between business central and data. So if you want to use at full power Power Apps and Power Automate and other products with Business Central, remember that now you have the possibility to use Dataverse or the common data service with your name. There are two points that you need to remember: that Dataverse is a data source for the Power Platform, native data source for the Power Platform, but Dataverse is not a data source for Business Central. So while from Power Platform, Power Apps and so on, you can directly connect to a Dataverse entity, from Business Central you can see a data entity natively, because Business Central don't rely on data as the database. It relies on Azure SQL database. So this is one of the things that you need to remember. And connection with Dataverse and Business Central today relies on two main types of technologies, if I can use these definitions. The first is what is called the data sync. So you can sync a Business Central entity with a Dataverse entity by defining what is called integration table mapping. So by defining that the customer entity, for example, is mapped to the CDS account entity. With this field mapping, you can define the field mapping, and you can also do that on custom entities with field mapping on CDS custom entities. And these entities are then synced to define the entities on Dataverse. So this is the first way of integration between Business Central and Dataverse. To do that is quite easy, because on Business Central now you have you can directly connect a Dataverse environment to a Business Central company. This can be created. This connection can be created. The first thing to remember is that you can connect multiple companies to a Dataverse environment, because a single Dataverse environment see companies as business unit. And to define the connections on Business Central, you simply select setup and extension, assisted setup, and then you have a new option called setup Dataverse connection. And this is where you start the connection. When you start this wizard, you need to specify the URL of the data environment you have, and this is auto-discovered by the account, with the account that you have logged in. So if your account can see these Dataverse environments, you are listed here and you select this Dataverse environment. And to start the synchronization, you need to sign in with an administrator credentials. When signed in, there's an important message here that say you that the user must exist on the common data service with the security roles as a system administrator and solution customizer. And when done that, you set up connections. You are prompted to choose an ownership model. And on this is recommended to select the team model, because this means that the entities are with C2 all your entire organization. And now the connection is synced. When the connection is established, you need to run a synchronization from Business Central. And from Business Central, you have a connection setup of a page where you can run a full synchronization. For example, is what is recommended at the beginning or at the first synchronization. And the full synchronizations permits you to see the list of entities that you want to sync from Business Central to Dataverse and so on. There are a set of standard entities, and you can also add other. And you can specify the direction of the synchronization. So if it's bidirectional and so on. When synced, you have an integration synchronization job logs where that shows you all the entities that are in sync. And when customizing the sync process, you can also specify what is called the integration field mapping. So you can also specify that when you select an entity, you can see a list of Business Central fields here. You can see a list of Dataverse column that this entity has in Dataverse, and you can map, for example, in this case, the name of the customer with the account name of the entity in Dataverse. And you can also, if needed, specify transformation rules. Transformation rules means that on some data, you don't want a direct one-to-one mapping, but you want to modify the mapping between Business Central and Dataverse. And this is the first way of integrations between Dataverse and Business Central. Before doing this very quickly, I want to show this. I'm going here in my Power, in my Dataverse environment, selected here. And you can also do this connection directly from Dataverse, because you can, for example, as you can see here, I created previously created a custom entity called vendor. And in this custom entity, I defined a set of custom columns, all these columns that are defined as a custom. And you can connect this entity defined in Business Central, defined on Dataverse with Business Central by clicking on Get Data. This is a scenario, in my opinion, useful, especially also for data analysis or something like that. If you want to use data analysis from Business Central to external tools, there are external tools that permit you to connect directly on Dataverse, and you can connect Business Central to Dataverse entities in this way. So the entity is defined, you can select your data. Here you can, for example, pass the URL of your entity exposed as APIs. And in this way, you can also do this. I connect it to my Business Central. Business Central, you have a page called Web Services. This is my tenant. You have a page called Web Services where you can publish a set of objects as web services, objects that are, can be pages or something like that. For example, I want to, in this case, expose the vendors. And if I select object type page, you can, I have a vendor, the vendor entity, the vendor list exposed as web services. One of the available here is the web vendor list. And okay, this is, you can simply copy this URL. It must be published. You can copy this URL. This is the OData before URL. And on Dataverse, you can copy this URL, specify the connection, select next. And in this way, the Dataverse connections connect to the entity in Business Central, retrieves all the data that comes from the API exposed. And these are the entity, the vendor details that my Business Central is exposing. And then you can map from here the fields that come from Business Central to Dataverse. So here you have the source column, Business Central columns, destination columns that are Dataverse columns created, and you can map the fields that you want. And when you have done that, You can also refresh manually the entity or refresh automatically. So for example, you can specify that I want this entity sync with Business Central on every 10 minutes or something like that. And in this way, the entity is exposed to Dataverse, and so you can have a sync. This is what is present now in Business Central, and also from the previous version of Business Central. But now you have a new possibility more that I think is extremely interesting. That is the what is called the virtual entities, Business Central Dataverse virtual entities. And a virtual entity is simply a virtual data source available on Dataverse that permits you to handle all of CRUD operations on an entity, so create, read, update, delete, and so on, directly from Dataverse on Business Central and vice versa. And the interesting part is that with virtual entities, data do not reside on Dataverse, but data continues to reside in Business Central. So there's no data synchronization between Business Central and Dataverse and vice versa. To do that, you need to install on your Dataverse environment an app available on AppSource that is called Business Central Virtual Entity. Actually, it's listed as public preview, as said at the beginning of this session. From this entity, you can see these applications permits you to sync, to permit you to Dataverse to see expose on Dataverse as virtual entities or the entities that you on Business Central you have exposed as APIs, so standard APIs and custom APIs, and these APIs can be consumed on Dataverse as virtual entities, and to generate these virtual entities, Business Central uses API metadata. So from API, the entity is created and generated at runtime. And under the hood, how this works. On Business Central, you have some tables that you want to expose to Dataverse. You create API pages on that tables, as said in the previous demo with Business Studio Code. This API page, when exposed, relies on the data. And the application that you have installed from AppSource has a component called Virtual Entity Plugin that translates all the entity from Business Center to virtual entities on Dataverse. And field names are created automatically based on API metadata. And these are exposed as virtual entities on Dataverse. So from Dataverse you can directly from the Dataverse database or from PowerApp, Power Automate or something like that, you can doing operations inside that entities, and these operations are returned back directly to Business Center because these entities are not stored on Business Center on Dataverse. To do that, when you install the Business Central Virtual Entities applications, these applications creates you a set of tools on Dataverse. One of these is the Business Central Virtual Data Source configuration, and this is the tool where you need to connect, permits you to connect Dataverse with Business Central for generating virtual entities. You need to specify here the environment and the company. And when you add that, you have automatically all the entities exposed by Business Central. And each of these entities has a relation with the company inside Business Central. So every virtual entity has a relation to a company. And you cross company queries are not supporting because you are, as in Business Central, you are working inside the company. So the customer that comes from Cronus IT are not the same that come from Cronus UK if you have two companies inside that same database. So all are work for company. And to generate or refresh virtual entities, you have a new entity called Available Business Central Entity, where you can select entities, decide that this entity will be visible to Dataverse, and you can also refresh automatically this entity. I will show this now. Let me close this. I previously installed that app. This app, the app that I was talking is available on AppSource and is the Business Central Virtual Table Preview app. You can use this app in production, but remember that actually this as preview because Microsoft is working on these apps. So as long as support is not cannot be guaranteed today. When you install it on your Business Central entities, you have a set of Sukikon solutions. You have a set of new applications available, new solutions available here. That you can see here. Yeah, I'm sorry if I have the Italian version here with names on Italian, but on English are the same, quite the same. These are some tools available here. To enable the usage of virtual entities, there's only one task to do in Business Central. It's to go on Azure T Directory application page, and you need to enable this line, the Dynamics 365 Business Central Virtual Entities application, because otherwise you cannot work. So this must be enabled. And when done that, on Dataverse, you can decide what virtual entity to expose to your application, to your Power Apps application or Power Automate application, or in general, Dataverse database. To do that, you go on tables. And if I select all the entities available, you have and select Business Central, you have an entity called Virtual Entity Configuration. And if you select this entity and you click on data, you can see that now you have Business Central listed. You select Business Central and you click on edit record. And here is where you define the connection. So here my connection, my Dataverse environment is connected to my production environment on Business Central. And the company inside the production environment is called Kronos IT. Here you can specify the connection to what environment you have. So the connection is defined here. When defined, you can go on, going on, not here, but going on tables again. And if I again select Business Central as filter, you have another entity called Available Business Central Entities. Here is where you the entity that you use to expose and create virtual entities. So if you select this and click on data, this connects to Business Central and downloads all the entities that your Business Central tenant exposes to Dataverse. So these are all entities, custom entities, and standard entities exposed as APIs from Business Central. As you can see here, we have account, we have customer, we have vendors, we have items, and all other, many, many other entities, attachment, balance sheet, country, region, and so on. As standard, these are virtual entities, so automatically exposed, but as you can see here, visible is set to no. So this means that this entity is exposed, but not visible to Power Apps or Power Automate. You need to be visible, you need to enable this. And for example, as you can see here, I have the vendor entity. I have previously enabled the vendor entity, so simply you select this, click on edit record, and you, from here, you can do two things. First thing is you click on visible, and this means that this entity now is visible from as virtual entities to Dataverse. So all the data that you have on the vendor table in Business Center is available in read-only to Dataverse. But here, there's also an important thing that sometimes someone forgets, that is the refresh fields. The refresh field is useful if you have, for imagine that you have a custom APIs that expose a custom entity, for example, a task entity that I previously created. I expose this entity to Dataverse, and then later I add a new field to this entity. If you don't refresh this entity, this new fields is not automatically visible to Dataverse. So if you add the new fields in the API, you should go on Dataverse, refresh the entity, and then this entity will be available to Dataverse as virtual. So virtual means that if Dataverse, if Power Apps, for example, uses the vendor item, the vendor entity, and modify a vendor, automatically the vendor is modified on Business Central. So extremely powerful for creating integrations, because imagine that you have a CRM system that want to talk with Business Central. Now you don't need a connector. Simply you can do in the sync via Dataverse. CRM reads and writes the vendor on Dataverse, and this modification is automatically seen on Business Central. And vendor is exposed. So if I click on tables again and I search for vendor, you can see that I have, this was the previously created custom entity. This is a standard entity. So this is a standard entity exposed by Business Central as virtual entity. So if I go on relationship, for example, you can see that there's a relation with a company. And you can see that I have some views exposed that you can customize. If I click on a view, you can see the data exposed by Business Central. And you can also customize this with all the fields that you are exposing from Business Central. You can customize view. So from here, you can start working exactly like you work normally in Power Automate or something like that. So you have exposed the Business Central data automatically. So I go switch back to slides. Remember that virtual entities are generated at runtime. So this is why the refresh operation that I showed before is important. And generated at runtime means that the Business Central uses two endpoints, or API endpoints, two new API endpoints available from Business Central 17. For creating virtual entities. One is the metadata endpoint, where you can see here that you have all the available entities exposed. And the other endpoint used is the entity definition endpoints. That is an endpoint that shows all the captions that you have on this entity. So this is why the translations and stuff like that is used automatically. All these Business Central virtual entities are exposed on Dataverse with this naming convention, so are called as in this name. So the intersified BC underscore entity name underscore publish underscore group underscore version. And there are some best practices when you create APIs for exposing as virtual entities, and you should use always system ID as the primary key. The system ID field as the primary key, and all foreign key should use the system ID too, so the GUIs too, and also all table fields and table relations and so on should be available as API pages, and all must be localized. What this means? This means that if I want to expose, for example, in this case, the item journals, the general journal to Business Central as to Dataverse as virtual entities, you need to create an API, but it's recommended to obviously set these properties that are the properties that define the APIs, but and use the OData key fields using the system ID, because Dataverse wants that, virtual entity wants that. So use the system ID as OData key fields on the API you are exposing. And if these APIs has a relationship, like in this case, the API journal, the journal batch has also the journal lines exposed, you need to define the API apart with the API journal lines page exposed. And it's important that the link between the header and the lines must be on the system ID fields. So remember that. And this is the way to expose a relationship between entities on Dataverse. And relationships can be of three types. One to N bidirectional directional relationship means that you have an header here and you have a lines. The lines must have a relationship specified by system ID. And where, if you have in this case, what happens on Dataverse is that from the journal entity, you can go to the journal lines. And from the journal lines, you can go to the journal. So the navigation from that in on Dataverse is bidirectional. If, and this is what you can see if you check the metadata, you can see that there's a new property called navigation property that shows you that the navigation is established. If instead you have a one end-to-one relationship, so for example, from my API journal lines, I have a field called account ID that has a relation with the account primary key. Remember that on Dataverse, from journal lines, you can go to the account, but from the account, you cannot go to all the, its journal lines. And the last relationship available is the one-to-one relationship. The one-to-one relationship means that you can have a field that is in relation with the account. For example, in this case, I have a field called agent AR that is in relation with the account ID. But the multiplicity of this relation is 0 or 1. You can now specify, it's a new property available on the API pages that permits you to specify the multiplicity of the relationship. So in this case, we are specifying that this relationship is one-to-one. And what that means that from the customer, you can go to the linked entity, the agent account receivable entity, but from this, you cannot go to the customer. This is actual limitation or relationships on the virtual entity generation. So remember this. But virtual entities are extremely powerful now for creating integrations. My personal, absolutely personal opinion is use Dataverse, start using Dataverse for doing integrations. Dataverse integrations can be, if you need read-only integration, so if you need to expose from Business Central to Dataverse, to an external system that uses Dataverse as database, an entity from Business Central, you don't need to go back. So for example, a BI system, the synchronization, my personal opinion is I will not use virtual entities for this, but you can create an entity on Dataverse and connect these entities, as seen in the first demo, connect these entities to a Business Central entity APIs, API entities. If instead you need read-write operations, so imagine integration between a CRM and Business Central, virtual entities are today a powerful way of doing that because you don't need to sync data. Data reside on Business Central, but entities are exposed as virtual on Dataverse, so each application available to talk with Dataverse, Power Apps, Power Automate, Power BI, CRM, and so on, can use and have a direct connection with Business Central. So this ends my overview of these new features available from business, the last version of Business Central. Remember that it's a public preview, so not all of this is actually in a stable state or finished state. Remember the survey. So